Okay. Good morning, dear participants, and good morning, Dr. Umesh Chandra Sahu, sir. He is the faculty member at the School of Infrastructure, IIT Bhubaneswar. He has obtained M.Tech degree from IIT Roorkee and PhD from IIT Kharagpur. His research area includes pavement analysis and design, low-volume roads, cool pavement, and recycling of asphalt pavement materials. He has published many international journals. Also, he is the reviewer of many journals. Also, he has undertaken many consultancy projects related to road base, sub base, and so on. And he is the principal technical agency of Odisha State, Jharkhand, and Chhattisgarh under PM Joshi and RRDA, Ministry of Rural Development, Government of India. So, thank you, sir. Thank you for joining us, for giving us the opportunity to deliver a talk in research and practices in civil engineering, RPC 2020, organized by ITC, Department of Civil Engineering, IIT Saran. So thank you, sir. Now continue, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Sujit and Pratik. So for giving me opportunity to speak on this occasion, on this short-term course, I'll be talking on pool payments. Let me share my slide.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, now are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I'll do that. Okay.
Yes, sir. Fine.
Okay, so today's topic is basically on pool payment. So some of you may be knowing what exactly is pool payment, some may not be knowing. We'll discuss in due course of time. Hope you will have a fair idea about the different technologies we adopt for developing pool payments. Okay, so let us first see why this is required. And by definition, if you see, this pool payment basically include a range of established and emerging technologies that communities are exploring as part of their heat island reduction effort. Okay, we'll discuss what is heat island. The term currently refers to the paving materials that reflect more solar energy and hence water evaporation, or have been otherwise modified to remain cooler than conventional pavement. So we are trying to basically reduce the pavement temperature. So whatever technology you use if that results in reduction in the pavement temperature, then we can consider that as a cool pavement technology. So basically, when you go for built environment, that means if you construct different infrastructure and all, has a profound impact on our natural environment, economy, health, and productivity. Increasing attention is being paid to reducing this environmental impact associated with each phase of the life cycle of various civil infrastructure. So we are now, the world is giving more attention now on different types of environmental impact associated with the infrastructure development. Economic and social development of both urban and rural areas continues as human population increases, especially in fast developing countries such as China, India, etc., which leads to more of land surface being paved. So when we are going for infrastructure development, surrounding and communication and all these things, for that we need to pave lands. Okay. So in many urban areas, a large percentage of this land area is covered with various types of pavements, including streets, parking areas, sidewalks, plazas, and playgrounds. So playgrounds also, they are also paved. Okay, some of the, like if you go with the tennis court and your other different types of courts, you also pave that. Okay. So let us understand what is basically this heat island effect. Okay, this term, the term heat island effect, actually first you can say defined by Akbari et al. They say that it can be described as the characteristics warmth of both the atmosphere and surfaces in developed urban areas compared to their non-urbanized surroundings. Okay, usually the nearby underdeveloped or undeveloped suburban and rural areas. So what is the comparative rise in temperature in a particular, you can see this particular graph, the comparative to its nearby rural or suburban area, what is the rise in temperature in the urban area, okay, and due to this development and infrastructural development and paving of more area in that, how that affect we'll see. So this rise in temperature we call as urban heat island effect. So we consider this urban area as an island, and where the temperature remains higher compared to its surroundings. Okay, so conversion of natural landscape into artificial structures has led to increase of about 10 to 21 degree centigrade in the urban surface temperature. So this elevated urban temperature has led to basically urban heat island effect. The conventional pavement surface temperature is normally 20 to 30 degree higher than the air temperature or surrounding temperature. You may be knowing that. Okay, so in the daytime you will see that the air temperature and pavement temperature is very different. Okay, and since the pavement absorbs the heat, so the temperature is normally higher than the air temperature. Also, the absorbed heat energy from the pavement surface, which is stored in the pavement subsurface, will be released into the atmosphere after the sunset or during the night time, keeping the heating or heating the atmosphere at the night time. So due to large area covered by the pavement in urban area, they are an important element to consider in heat island mitigation. So if you are planning to mitigate this heat island effect, so then you should think of the pavements, which are covering a major part of the infrastructure developing in urban areas. So heat islands are also attracting more attention of various global organizations. For instance, if you see the leadership in energy and environmental design, a green building certification program from US Green Building Council awards now points to new construction and major renovations for using various technologies and strategies for roof and non-roof. So you can say roof means basically buildings, for buildings in and other than buildings, non-roofs including roads, sidewalks, courtyards and parking lots, etc., to reduce the heat island effect and to minimize the impact on microclimates and human and wildlife habitats. So all this increase in temperature has direct effect on the climate as well as human and wildlife habitats. So in addition, mitigating these heat islands and improving outdoor thermal environments is important for creating a walkable and livable sustainable community. Nowadays we are more focusing like we should go for more walking and using more a bicycle and all these things. But if your pavement temperature is very high and the surrounding temperature is very, it is very difficult to go for these activities like in terms of your walking and cycling and all these things. So people normally do not prefer in those conditions. So that's why to improve the outdoor thermal environment, it is important to mitigate this heat island effect. So what are the effect of urban heat island? In nutshell, if you see, it will reduce the air and water quality. Okay, disturbance in local wind patterns, in climatic problems, increase in energy consumption. That means if the temperature rises, you will go for more air conditioning and all these things. So a lot of energy consumption is there. Reduction in human thermal comfort. So health issues, some people may get a lot of health issues due to rise in temperature and all. So if you see, almost 8% of the total electricity generated in US, because we don't have statistics of this, but US have some statistics. So as per the statistics released, almost 8% of the total electricity generated in US is used to meet the air conditioning demand. Okay, so this and most of the thing is like related to the rise in temperature in the urban areas. Okay, so the key reasons leading to this urban heat island effect are basically higher absorption of solar energy. So the payments or other infrastructure, they absorb higher solar energy, so you can think of reducing that absorption. Then anthropogenic heat developed, then reduced thermal losses. We'll see one by one. Other effects on payments, if you see, when there is an increase in the air temperature, there is a subsequent increase in the payment temperature also. So with increase in the payment temperature, what happens? It reduces the stiffness of the binder and there will be more rutting, okay, which leads to rutting and bleeding and also binder sticking to the tire. So when the bitumen becomes soft at high temperatures, these are the issues. And also this causes early aging, stiffening, because oxidation happens due to high temperature, and which causes aging and stiffening and development of premature cracks under the loads, repeated loads. In concrete pavements also, similarly, this repeated temperature curling results in transverse longitudinal corner cracks. So also the temperature difference is more between the in a concrete pavement, you will see that the thermal stresses are high and it results in different types of cracks in concrete pavements. So it affects both the type of pavements structurally. So to mitigate all this heat island effect, we can think of cool pavements. So the cool pavements can be broadly categorized into three types, depending upon the different technologies developed till date. Okay, so one is a reflective pavement, second is evaporative pavements, third is modification of heat storage, okay, technique. In the reflective pavement, what normally we do is that we go with lighter colored pavements. That means if you see a concrete pavement and vis-a-vis an asphalt pavement, the asphalt pavement color is dark and concrete pavement color is light. So, and that's why the concrete pavement, you can say they contribute lesser towards the urban heat island effect. Okay, so lighter colored pavements with high albedo value. Okay, albedo value is actually the parameter which is used to used to quantify the reflection characteristic or reflective property of the pavements or any surface. Okay, so evaporative pavements, this holds the water. Okay, and those water can be again used for cooling. Okay, with evaporation. Okay, and the third one is modification of heat storage. For that, we can use different PCM, phase change materials. Okay, so the phase change materials can be incorporated into the pavements. Okay, and you can also go for high conductive pavements, and also you can go with heat harvesting pavement. Different kind of technology where you are trying to change the heat energy into different other forms, and then you can make the pavements cooler. Let us first understand what basically is reflective pavements. Okay, as we all know, major part of the solar radiation is reflected from the pavement surface. Okay, so if you have actually a larger part of the area is covered with some paving, then it gets reflect back, and whether it is building, whether it is road and other thing, it goes back. Okay, so major part of solar radiation is reflected from the pavement surface, and it absorbs comparatively lower thermal energy and remains cooler. So that's why it's suggested only for open areas exposed to sunlight for a long time with hot and dry climate. Okay, so if you are going with reflective pavements, okay, so where you are trying to reflect back most of these radiations, okay, there are short waves and long waves. So most of the short wave radiations are reflected back to the sky. Okay, so and that's why lesser energy, thermal energy is absorbed by the pavements, and that's why they remain cooler. Okay. this require direct sunlight to be direct sunlight access, so these are actually suggested for open areas which are exposed to sunlight, and most of the roads are meeting this requirement. Okay, and increase of if you see from a research, it has been found that increase of albedo value by 0.1 decreases the pavement temperature by 5 to 6 degrees centigrade. So if you increase the albedo value, which is a parameter of your reflection characteristics of a surface, by just 0.1, then there is a decrease in temperature by about 5 to 6 degrees centigrade. Okay? This may vary from different surface also. So if you see, this is a picture taken from one research by Harvey et al. 2013, and they have conducted some thermal camera or thermal imagery. Can see these are the surfaces, concrete surfaces, asphalt surface, and paver blocks. So they have used three different types of pavement surfaces and tried to find out the temperature, surface temperature of these pavements. Okay, in peak periods. So if you see the C1, C2, C3, and these values given in the bracket are nothing but the albedo values. Okay, so if you see this concrete, since the color is lighter, you will see higher albedo values, okay, and higher albedo is 0.29, 0.18, and 0.26. And here actually they have used some, you can say, different reflective coatings also they have used in some of the pavements, which actually is increasing this albedo values, okay. And this is an asphalt pavement where the albedo value is very low, and it's actually 0.09, 0.08 of that order. Whereas if you go for paver blocks, okay. Paver blocks with lighter colored pavements, then it is having albedo values of 0.28, 0.25, and all. So you can see, and because this is having joints where actually there will be percolation of water. So here both the things works, the light colored surface as well as the water or evaporative pavement concept, both works that way. You basically the temperature reduction is slightly higher. Okay, so reflective pavements can be developed by applying a reflective coating, by applying IR reflective colored coatings. IR means infrared reflective colored coatings. You can also go for applying thermochromic coating. You can also go for incorporating heat reflective coated aggregates. You can also go for utilizing fly ash and slag in cement concrete pavement where the heat absorption is lesser. So let us understand how it works. Okay, and if you see some of the limitations, okay, are basically glare related issues, because when you are making the pavement lighter, under the light the glare actually affects the eyes of the driver and accident may happen. So that's why this is one of the major limitation of reflective pavements. And also adversely affect the thermal comfort of pedestrians, vehicles, and nearby buildings, because this when the reflection happens, the reflection goes in different directions, and the rays which are reflected back, they are affecting the nearby features. So the comfort of pedestrian, vehicles, and nearby buildings are affected by this reflection. So this actually, let us understand how this reflective pavement works. Okay, so here this is the incoming solar radiation, and here the reflections. Okay, some portion of the short waves are reflected back to the atmosphere, which is good, which is actually our intention. It should reflect it back. Some of them basically are reflected at different angles. Here this is being reflected towards the pedestrians, reflected towards the vehicle, reflected towards the buildings. So as I told, this adversely affect the thermal comfort of the pedestrians, vehicles, and nearby buildings. Okay, so this is actually the one of the limitation of the reflective pavements. Okay, so this can be taken up with different types of interventions. Let us see how this can be done. So this can be addressed basically by using retroreflective payments. Okay. So this is something which has been a recent advancement in case of reflective payments, where we normally use use some technology where the direction of the solar radiation and the direction of reflection is the same. Okay, so we use some retroreflective elements in the payment, which actually reflects back in the same direction to the atmosphere. Okay, so these are some of these technologies, retroreflective technologies that have been evolved over the over recent times. Okay, in this, what happens? And if you see the earlier picture, earlier image, it was showing that some of the rays are actually getting diverted towards the vehicle, towards the pedestrian buildings. But here, by using retroreflective payment, retroreflective materials, what is happening? It is going back in the same direction to the atmosphere. So there is no issue at all in terms of the other. So one of the limitation you can say has been overcome by using retroreflective solar radiation technologies. Okay. Then comes the second type of payment, which is we call as your evaporative payment. Okay. What is evaporative payment? Evaporative payment means it holds water. Okay. It holds water for evaporative cooling. Okay. And here the latent heat for the liquid vapor phase transition of the water is utilized for cooling. So when actually you need to understand this phase changing of the materials, whether it is water or some other material, actually when the phase changes from one state to the other state, there is some energy which is consumed. So energy consumed means actually you are giving or that heat is actually dissipated. Okay, the heat dissipated means there is a cooling effect. Okay, so here in case of this evaporative cooling, what we do is that whatever water is there in liquid form, that evaporates under the action of sun, and that converts into vapor. Okay, so during that process, there is some energy which is being dissipated, heat energy being dissipated, and in that process the payment remains cooler. So that these are suggested for rainy and humid climatic conditions. Okay, so if you have frequent rains and is a humid condition, so then such kind of technologies will be very much useful. And but wherever the water availability is not there, this cannot be used, and this will be serious issue. So it cannot be implemented properly. And these evaporative payments again can be classified into different groups, such as your porous payment, permeable payments. Okay, porosity and permeability are two different terms you need to understand. Okay, porous means actually there are pores, but these are not interconnected. Permeable, which is interconnected. Okay, then also some people call pervious payment, some call water retaining payments. We'll see actually what are these different types of payment and how these payments are contribute towards cool payments. This is basically a phase changing phenomena where solid to liquid, and this particular zone is called this latent heat heat of fusion, and this is called latent heat of vaporization. Here actually we use the concept of latent heat of vaporization in case of evaporative payments. Latent heat of fusion we will see in another technology in case of your phase changing material things. So latent heat is basically the latent heat temperature remains constant. Okay, but the phase changes from solid to liquid, or maybe liquid to vapor. Depending upon that, it is called latent heat of fusion or latent heat of vaporization. So one of the technologies called porous payments, or we normally use porous concrete, porous asphalt, and all these things. So which allows the water to pass through that, and then it is retained in the sub layers, and then under the solar heat, this evaporates, and then during this evaporation, the cooling of the payment happens. Porous pavements, actually, these have internal holes. It can be like these blocks, or it can have internal holes in between. The blocks can be any pattern, and filled with grass, sand, etc. to retain water. Okay. And the fillers are also provided inside the cellular grid system that covers around 20 to 50% area of the pavement. So this actually this holds water, and this water ultimately is used in the evaporating cooling process and developing the cool pavement technology. The other one is basically pervious pavement, okay, highly porous in nature, where basically you can use porous paver blocks here in the top, and then below that you can use sand and gravel. You can also have the actually typical porous pavement design or pervious pavement design, where you actually have different layers through which water can penetrate and then infiltrate into the subsoil. That is the what, or if you have excess, that will overflow through this pipe. Okay, so these are actually, this is called retention pond or retention trench, where the water is stored for some time. So usually these are made of single graded aggregates, allows the direct passage of water through the pavement structure, and permeability is in the range of 0.097 to 0.000097 meter per second. Okay, and a major part of this percolating water is drained immediately. So here, if actually the runoff is very high, or the percolation is very high, you can also put overflow pipes where it can be drained. This permeable pavements, again, actually this can be of different configurations. You can see, you can provide these three images. You can see the first one shows use of a pervious concrete paved surface. Second one is a pervious or porous asphalt paved surface. The third one is interlocking block pavements, okay, paver blocks. So all these three is pervious concrete, porous asphalt, or permeable interlocking concrete pavers can be used for construction of your evaporative pavements, okay, or permeable pavements. Okay, here this allows the rainwater to pass around the pavement, and water is stored in the lower pavement layers. Okay, and evaporation of the water through the evaporation channel basically keeps the pavement cool. This is basically water retaining pavement. Okay, where in the top surface we use some or we try to keep some porosity, or we use some material which can retain the water for some time, and then in that case we call this as a water retaining pavement. Okay, so this is the image of that, and the top layer, this is not, actually this is not linked with the other layers, where in case of permeable pavement we allow the water to pass through the subgrade layer, but here we are just limited to the top layer, where the water is held for some time, and then under the solar heat this evaporates, and then during this process the heat is dissipated and the pavement remains cooler. Okay, so fillers are utilized to hold the water. Blast furnace slag, pervious mortar, etc. can also be used as fillers in water retaining pavements. Okay, so what are the limitations of evaporative pavements? Okay, lower solar reflectance or albedo, because we are going with if we are going with concrete, that's fine. If we are going with asphalt, the solar reflectance will be lower. If you compare with the reflective pavements, of course it will be lesser, because we are not using any coating on the surface. We are just going with the normal pavement making road making materials. Okay, in the absence of water, the lower thermal mass of evaporative pavements leads to elevated pavement temperature. So in the absence of water, the lower thermal mass, if you actually this is a dry area, or the there is no rains, then what happens, there will be no water for making it cool. In that case, the lower thermal mass of evaporative pavements leads to elevated pavement temperatures. Okay, so water contained at depths near the pavement surface only will contribute towards the evaporative cooling, because this is only this evaporation happens at certain temperature, and that temperature only actually in the pavement will reach actually in the top few centimeters. Okay, so if even if there is water at the lower layers, this actually these are less effective in evaporative cooling. Okay, so that's why this water retaining pavements is a development over the earlier pavements, so that since only the top few centimeters are effective in evaporative cooling, only that layer can be used for cool pavements. So increased humidity level near to pavement surface decrease the swept cooling of pedestrians. Migrating pollutants into the groundwater. So if there are actually, because the water is flowing, so if there is some pollutant and all, so ultimately it is going to the groundwater through the percolation. So what are the recent advantages or advancements to overcome these limitations? You can actually go with evaporation enhancement pavements. Okay, so how can we go? We'll see. In which basically we normally go with capillary columns, okay, to lift the water. As we discuss, this evaporation cooling is limited to top few centimeters. Okay, so water content at depths near to the pavement surface will only contribute towards evaporative cooling. So this is one of the major limitations. So that's why we can go with evaporation enhancing pavements, in which capillary columns are provided to lift the water captured by the liner to the surface. Just see here, this is actually a typical of typical evaporative pavement where we are using capillary columns. So the water is stored normally in the bottom layers, okay, and then if you are providing capillary columns here, then water can again come back to the top layers. If this water is lost in evaporation, and then immediately through capillary action the water comes again, and then wets this surface, and then again evaporative cooling continues. Okay, so these are designed to manage storm water at regions with high water table. So if the region is having high water table, this kind of pavements are better. Liner is provided to prevent the entry of pollutants into the groundwater. So you can provide some screens or some kind of filters, so that you can actually reduce this entry of pollutants into the groundwater. Okay, up to 9.4 degree centigrade cooling can actually be done by using this permeable pavements compared to the conventional pavements. These evaporative pavements are normally cooler than the conventional permeable pavements. So the last one is basically modification of the heat storage. Okay, in this basically we have three different types. One is a heat harvesting pavement. Okay, in the heat harvesting pavement, what we normally do is basically the absorbed heat in pavements is extracted by embedded solar collectors. So there will be some collectors embedded into the pavements, which will collect this heat energy from the pavements. Okay, and then that is used for other beneficial works. Okay, so asphalt pavements absorb more solar heat. Okay, and that's why they are considered as favorable compared to this concrete pavements. Okay, if you are going with heat harvesting pavements. Okay, so heat energy is harvested by combining basically the asphalt solar collectors with a piping system and embedded generator. Okay, we'll see what is this. This is a typical heat harvesting pavement where you are trying to harvest energy from the heat. Okay, So here what you are doing is that you are using a system of pipes embedded inside that, as well as you have some solar collectors, okay, so inside that, okay, heating element, solar heating element, those are heated through the heat absorbed by the pavements from solar radiations. Okay, so this is how you are converting this heat energy to heat the cool water and to get the hot water. So actually this is cool water is green and hot water you can say is actually red here. So this can be used, hot water can be used for different other purposes. Okay, in cold countries this is very much beneficial. So however there are certain limitations of heat harvesting payments. This cannot be subjected to high traffic conditions because this is you are embedding different other foreign materials into the pavements, and these are actually embedded at a very shallow depth. So the traffic stress, high traffic stresses will damage these structures, this arrangement. So that's why high traffic is normally not allowed with heavy vehicle loadings. So this is one of the limitation of this heat harvesting payment. Then sloped payment requires additional these payments. You can see these are actually slope payments for easy flow of the water. So sloped payment requires additional energy to pump the circulated fluid under the payment. So if you are circulating a fluid through the pipes, so that needs additional power or generator. Then heat harvesting payment system is left idle most of the time, and that's why corrosion may happen. Okay, so actually after putting it in into the payment, you normally leave it. So after some time you may feel that you may find that there corrosion may happen because you are using metallic things for such arrangements. Then construction and maintenance of heat harvesting payments may be costly because you are embedding. So any problem associated with this system will actually necessitate again disturbing the payment system, okay, which will be a costly affair. The second one is high conductive payment. Okay, so increasing the thermal conductivity reduces the maximum pavement temperature, surface temperature. That means if your pavement is conductive, highly conductive, the temperature is actually goes to the bottom layers. Okay, so the thermal conductivity is high. Materials like graphite are added to increase the thermal conductivity. So if you can add graphite like materials, it will increase the thermal conductivity of different layers, and subsequently the temperature is transferred from the surface to the bottom layers. Okay, so heat energy stored in the pavement and will discharge at night time. So most of the heat energy will stored at the bottom layers, and slowly it will be discharged during the night time. This leads to higher night time surface temperature than the common pavements. The third and the most recently or most recent technology in case of modification of heat storage thing is use of phase change materials, okay, which are incorporated into the pavements. Okay, we are also carrying out research in this direction now at IIT Bhubaneswar. Here we are using basically some phase changing materials to make the pavements cooler than the conventional pavements. So in this it can store comparatively higher energy per unit mass without much variation in the temperature. Okay, so we're using some phase change materials which can actually store energy, heat energy, okay, without much variation in the temperature, and restrict the temperature extremes in concrete and asphalt pavements. So it will not allow the pavement to rise. Rather, the heat energy is being dissipated through a phase changing mechanism. Okay, so this is how actually the phase change material works. Okay, this is the environment temperature which rises, And with rise in the environment temperature, the phase change material also, the temperature rises and the phase changes from solid to liquid. We normally go with the solid liquid phase change material. Okay. And then the managed temperature remain constant. So whatever temperature you are intending for the payment, that remains constant. Okay. So, and then this phase change happens, and in the night time, what happened? The environment temperature fall. So there is a reduction in the temperature during night time. The phase change material become solid because this phase again changes back, and the managed temperature remains constant. Okay, this is how actually this melting and crystallization thing happens, and during this process, the payment the payment temperature remains in a controlled or at a controlled level. So if you see different phase change materials which can be used actually, and their temperature rise, okay, per 5000 kilojoule, okay, this is actually different types of material. This is actually what happens. Actually, we normally target for this kind of thing. The temperature reduction is not very high, but still that much temperature reduction can be very much advantageous. You can see the top one is a conventional, the blue black one is a conventional payment temperature cycle. Okay, this is high temperature and this is low temperature. So if you see actually at certain high temperature or a temperature below certain level, it gives you a lot of damaging or causes a lot of damage to the payment in different forms. Okay, but however, if you can restrict that payment temperature below that critical limit, then your damages can be reduced drastically. Similarly, for low temperature also, if you are going extreme into the low temperature, that makes the payment brittle. But however, if you can restrict the payment temperature within some critical limit, then it can take infinite number or it can more number of fatigue repetitions. Okay, so this actually causes more of rutting if at high temperature and more of fatigue at low temperature. So both the things can be balanced by putting some phase change materials into the payments, and that can control the payment temperature. Different types of PCMs are used. So if you see what are the desirable properties of an ideal PCM, you need to see, understand its thermal properties, physical properties, kinetic properties, chemical properties, and ultimately the economic factor, because you cannot put gold into the payments or roads. So you need to be economy, because you are engineers. We need to understand what that how much you can invest to get a desired output. In terms of thermal properties, it should have higher latent heat of fusion and specific heat capacity per unit volume. Okay, and it should have higher thermal conductivity, and it should be acceptable it should have acceptable phase change temperature. Okay, so we need a particular temperature range at which the payment temperature varies. Okay. So that normally it varies within the temperature range of 35 to 50 degrees centigrade. Within that, you have to choose a particular type of PCM. Physical properties, minimum change in volume should happen, because when the phase changes, there is a volume change also. So that volume change should also be minimal, because it will otherwise affect the material or medium through which it is incorporated into the payments. And it should not degrade after multiple freeze thaw cycle or you can say a solid liquid cycles. Okay, higher it should have a higher density, and it should have a higher rate of crystal growth. It should have lower degree of supercooling. It should have higher nucleation rate. It should be chemically stable, non flammable, then non corrosive and non toxic. And in terms of economic, it should be inexpensive and available in large quantity, so that it can use, because the payment and road construction always require higher volumes. Okay, and when you try to put this PHA material into some medium, then there is always a chance that when it becomes liquid, that will come out from that. So normally what you do is that the PCM is encapsulated. We try to cover it with some other material so that the PCM remains inside that material. Okay, so this we can use a cell or encapsulation material. Within that you can put the PCM into that, or else you can use some porous material through which you can actually put the PCM in liquid form, and then you can cover the surface so that the material remains inside. Okay, so covering the PCM with a proper cell or coating is very much required, and PCMs adversely affect the physical and rheological property of the asphalt. If this encapsulation breaks, then this liquid or PCM liquid will adversely affect the real physical and rheological properties of the bitumen. So that's why you need to be careful in that. And PCMs reduce the mechanical strength of the concrete, because you are using some lower quality aggregate, that those are porous. So that's why it reduces the strength of concrete or the asphaltic layer. So that has to be properly designed. However, there are certain benefits of the PCM encapsulation. This holds the PCM during the phase change, maintains the purity of the PCM by isolating it from surrounding materials, provide flexibility during frequent state change, increase thermal and mechanical stability, okay, and compatibility for certain uses such as food storage and all these things. So this is not actually intention. So food storage is some other advantage we should not consider for road construction. So this is actually different PCM encapsulation for pavement applications. It can be actually put inside pipes. So if you can lay pipes inside the pavements and then fill PCM inside that, then that also can work. But putting pipes is again a costly affair, and then putting PCM into that may not be that feasible. But this has been done in lab scale and has been found to be successful. Other one, as we have discussed, you can use porous aggregates, lightweight aggregates, and then you can put PCM inside that and then put it into the concrete or asphalt pavement for reduction in the temperature. Okay, if you see the thermal performance of different types of PCM incorporated pavements, this is actually the graph. You can see the yellow one is basically asphalt layer without PCM, and you see this is actually highest, showing the highest temperature. Okay, and then below that is actually the asphalt layer with PCM. Okay, and then this is the dotted line is basically aggregate layer with PCM. So you are actually using aggregate layers with PCM. We are using actually directly, we are using some PCM inside that. Okay, asphalt layer with PCM material directly you are putting here. Then you are using aggregate layers also in PCM. So accordingly, if you can use in different layers, you can actually reduce the pavement temperature significantly. Okay, different types of PCMs are available. You can actually choose a particular type of PCM depending upon your need. PCMs are actually used by mechanical people for most of the cooling things and all, and maintaining temperature. So however, use in road pavements is still a new area where people are working. So different types of PCMs are available: unsaturated organic acid, paraffin, saracene, polyethylene glycol, of other temperature, then ecosane, paraffin wax. So different types of PCMs are available, and it's used in different types of pavement have also been studied by different researchers, and then they have reported temperature reduction in laboratory scale and in field scale also. Okay, so you can see in paraffin you can able to reduce the field temperature by around 3.5 degrees centigrade. Using polyethylene glycol, you can actually reduce up to 7 degrees centigrade in lab and 4.3 in the field. You can using saracene, in asphalt, you can reduce up to 8.5 degree centigrade and 7 degree in the field. So actually you need to actually understand what kind of material will be suitable for you, and then how to put it into some medium, and then how to encapsulate, and then how to use it pavement layers. This all actually needs a good amount of research to understand this thing, and then to come out with sustainable technologies. So coming to the summary, mitigation of heat island effect is essential, as we have understood, is essential for sustainable development of infrastructure, and cool pavements, development of cool pavements is or are a step forward in this direction. Okay, because everybody is now concerned about the climate change, about the environment and all these things. So if we can actually do a little bit to that by reducing the surrounding temperature through different cool pavement technologies, then of course this will be a method which will add towards sustainable development of infrastructure. Cool pavements can be developed by use of different pavement technologies, as we have already discussed during last 1 hour. It can be highly reflective paved surface or reflective pavement. It can be evaporative pavement, or it can be used like increase in the thermal inertia of the pavement through heat storage and all these things, or heat harvesting pavement. So different technologies are available under each. Whether you are going with reflective pavement, or you are going with evaporative pavement, or heat storage pavements. So there are different technologies you can use. Reflective pavements effectively reduce the pavement temperature, but increases the glare related issues, thermal load on pedestrian traffic, and temperature on nearby buildings. So we have already seen that part, and that can be controlled by using retro reflective materials, which can actually reflect back in the same direction of the solar rays. So can be considered in different applications. The lower thermal inertia and solar reflectance of evaporative pavements results in higher pavement temperature in the absence of water. So if in case of evaporative pavements, if that area is water table is higher and is actually humid and rainy area, so then this technology works fine. But however, if there is absence of water, these pavements becomes the temperature of the pavements become higher. Okay, so that is one of the limitation that should be considered while adopting such technology for a particular area. Heat harvesting pavements are costly, and further research is required to increase the strength of pavements also. So you need to understand the cost of different solutions that you are using for developing heat harvesting pavements, and also by putting these different foreign materials into the pavement structure, it reduces the pavement strength, so load carrying capacity. So necessary research or further research should be done so that the cost can be minimized as well as the strength can be improved at the same time. Increasing the thermal conductivity of the pavements leads to a cooler daytime and hotter nighttime pavement surface temperature. So if you can actually increase the thermal conductivity of the materials used in different layers of a pavement, then you can actually reduce the daytime temperature significantly, and however there will be slight increase in the nighttime temperature. Normally it's comfortable. Okay, incorporation of PCMs can effectively reduce the pavement temperature. So if as we have already discussed in some of the slides, you can use different types of phase change materials, which has been found to reduce the pavement temperature effectively. Okay, and however, PCM will adversely affect the properties of asphalt and concrete, and hence you need to ensure proper encapsulation method, okay, to address this particular problem. Selection of suitable PCM depends on the environmental condition, while the method of encapsulation is purely the engineer's choice. So you need to understand the PCM type, its mechanism, its mechanical properties, its thermal properties and all. So, and at the same time, you need to understand the encapsulation method that you are going to put on that, so that the stresses coming onto this PCM encapsulated materials is lesser, and this can sustain the type of load coming onto the onto these elements, okay, through vehicular loadings. Okay, so this actually needs a clear understanding of choice of a particular type of technology, depending upon the climate, depending upon the traffic, okay, and depending upon the surroundings and all these things, you have to call for a type of technology, and also you need to design it properly so that it can be used for traffic of different category. Okay, so these are some of these references. You can go to one of our reference which is published in Construction and Building Materials. This is a review, and if you want to do research in fetch in material, this will be a guiding document. You can follow this. Thank you. So any queries, I will be happy to take up for a few minutes.
Thank you, sir, for giving a nice lecture on cool payments. And participants have asked certain questions. If you will give permission, then I will ask you some questions on behalf of participants.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, sir, thanks. Sir, first question, as the cool payments reflects much more light, so that it will create problem during
during
driving of vehicle, it will create also problem for drivers.
Yeah, that is one of the limitation of reflective payment, as I have already mentioned that. So you need to keep a balance between the reflective characteristics and the glare effect. Okay, it should not be very light or reflective, which will actually hamper the driving behavior of the or the behavior of the drivers. Okay.
Sir, this payment really, this can be used in urban road, village road, all types of road?
Yes, this can be used cool in payment. All types. Yes, cool payment, you can use it all types. In urban, you can actually go with porous payments, and or you can go with fetch and material, you can go with heat harvesting payment, any kind of technology, depending upon the climate, as we have discussed, if there is the water table is high or a humid area, you can go with evaporative payments. Most of now, many people are designing porous payments, so you can go with porous payment design, for which will actually give you two types of solutions. One is your recharging groundwater, at the same time it will also result in a cool payment. So both the things you can, but however, the you need to understand the load carrying capacity of such payment, and accordingly you have to choose its application, whether you need for light traffic roads, whether you need for parking areas, whether you need for high traffic road, then high traffic road porous payment, or actually this porous payment, permeable payments, still actually things needs to be researched properly.
Basically there will be color coating on the payment.
Yes,
basically there will be color coating on the payment.
Yes.
So if due to heavy traffic or any type of traffic movement, due to tire and payment interaction, so the color may be removed. So what is the age?
Yes,
age of that color, or how much time it will take?
Yes. Actually, that is again another cost. You need to find out some cost effective solution, because there will be wear and tear under the vehicle tire. So what you can do is that you can actually use some pigment in the concrete itself. Okay, so it can not be a coating on that. Sometimes it can be part of your structure. Okay. Lighter pigment you can use in the concrete layer itself, which actually will give you a lighter surface.
Sir, it can be used as in a WMA pavement also, or only
Formix. Yes, Formix asphalt. Any pavement you can apply. Actually, it is you have to understand the technology and you can apply to any kind of pavement. It can be, you can use it for asphalt pavement, you can use it for concrete pavement, you can use for block pavements. So you can use it for any kind.
Okay, sir. If water is used to cool the pavement, you have shown in one of your slides, then binding property of bitumen will be affected.
Of course.
So how to overcome this?
Porous pavement has always a problem associated with that, but still we keep a balance with that. So the porous pavement or porous asphalt are designed in such way that the moisture sensitivity remains within the desirable criteria, and the minimum load carrying capacity should also be there. Then only we go for or actually during the design mix itself it is taken care.
Okay, sir. Sir, in case of porous
pavement, one of the major issues with porous pavements is the clogging. So the clogging of the pores through the dust and other things has always been a major problem, and that is always associated with the declogging maintenance. So in advanced countries they do declogging, and all over India where we do not get sufficient funds for maintenance, declogging and other things is difficult, but still in some urban municipality areas it can be applied.
Okay, sir, in case of porous format, as water is percolating up to the subgrade level or surface level, so yes, it will cause more pumping. So how to solve this problem actually?
You need to understand that. You need to use such kind of soil which will not cause mud pumping. You have to use granular soils. Okay, in the subgrade also, you need to have soils which are sandy or granular in nature, which will have low plasticity.
Sir, if you will provide some drainage system below the porous pavement. So if there is a length of the road is more, like 5 kilometer, 10 kilometer, 15 kilometer, is it possible to provide a system below the porous pavement?
Yes, you can do that. You can actually put an integrated drainage system.
Hello?
Where you can collect the water through one of the pavement layers, and then you collect the water at the sides, and then you can use those water in your way, or you can have different other harvesting mechanism where water can be put into the groundwater or used for recharging the groundwater. Ultimately, it should go to recharge the groundwater. That should be ensured.
Okay, sir. Sir, all methods that you have described here are good in a structural point of view, but all methods are cost effective?
No, actually you have to go for a balance. When you do not have choice, like your heat is increasing day by day, there is global warming is happening, so you need to put your efforts to reduce the temperature, so you need to go for cost effective solutions for that. And you can go for a life cycle cost analysis to see what kind of payment will be suitable. And in that life cycle cost analysis, you can consider the environmental effects into account, and that will ultimately reduce your life cycle cost compared to conventional payments. If you consider environmental effects.
Another point. Okay, sir. Can you take another 2 or 3 question?
Yes, yes.
Sir, can you take another 2 or 3 question?
Yes, okay. Yes. Okay, can I answer?
Sir, okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, are the HMA leads to increase the temperature or heat island effect? Then nowadays the NHAI preferring HMA, rather than any type of a payment that you have described here. So please, sir, convince them or advise them to apply some other methods.
No, actually, flexible payment and concrete payment have their own advantages and disadvantages in terms of life, in terms of maintenance, in terms of cost, and in terms of availability of materials, bitumen and all. Bitumen again is a waste material which needs to be utilized. So, and the one of the major application is roads. So we have a lot of refineries, so that generates lots of asphalt or bitumen that needs to be utilized also, and that gives you a more noise free payment compared to this concrete payments. So there are advantages and disadvantages, and if you see maintenance is much easier in case of flexible payments. So keeping everything in mind, actually we can incorporate phase change materials into the asphalt layers to reduce its temperature. So there can be other like you can use porous asphalt also in the surface and then make a permeable pavement structure, and then that can be used as a cool pavement technology, as evaporative pavements. If not for structural roads, you can use it for parking areas, you can use it for other paving areas where light traffic is going, there also you can use.
So, okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Give a very good presentation. And this is a new topic also. Now is in the emerging stage. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation to deliver a talk in RPC 2020. So, okay. Thank you, sir. And stay safe. And thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Thank you, and all the best for the rest of your program. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye. Hello.
हाँ
सर, दिस इज ऑडिबल.
हाँ ऑडिबल
सर.
यस.
ओके. सो डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स, नाउ यू हैव अनदर लेक्चर. सर
हाँ,
मनोस्नी इज कमिंग जस्ट साइड हर्स. मनोस इज कमिंग इन पिक्चर ऑफ देन. हाँ, अगेन कमिंग सर.
एंटायर स्क्रीन.
No, sir. So I will tell.
Okay.
Yes, sir, Manushin is coming in the picture as well.
Okay.
So, dear participants, now we have another lecture. Dr. Ravindra Kumar Kaur. He is the associate professor in the Department of Civil Engineering, IIT Sarang. And he has 26 years of experience in teaching and industries. And he is also the state technical agency of PMGC Road under NRRDA, Government of India. And he will present on green, white, the pink pavement. So, welcome, sir.
Okay,
and proceed, sir. Sir, you press the present now button, sir. Just open the PPT. First, open the PPT and minimize it.
First is PPT.
First open the PPT, then minimize it. After minimization, then present now.
এটা করিও করি এটা हाँ ये वे
थोड़ा थे
हाँ ये विंडो जस्ट गुड 10 मिनट सेटा सुन हाँ पावर पॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन तो स्क्रीन नेस दे जी मैं पछे रे
ताको मिनिमाइज कर दे तू जस्ट मिनिमाइज
कर दी
देन प्रेजेंट नाउ
हाँ पावर पॉइंट हाँ तापर पावर पॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन खोल ली गूगल मीट की गली तापरे हाँ प्रेजेंट नाउ की क्लिक कर ली हाँ ये विंडो क्लिक कर ली हाँ देखो जी देखो जी अच्छा ठीक है चलो आशीला ठीक है फुल स्क्रीन असला तो गुड मॉर्निंग डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स जस्ट विल स्टार्ट दिस प्रेजेंटेशन व्हिच इज द गाइडलाइंस फॉर कन्वेंशनल एंड थिन व्हाइट टॉपिंग इन इंडिया सो कमिंग टू द इंट्रोडक्शन नाउ द करेंट सिनेरियो ऑफ रोड कंडीशंस इन इंडिया सो हियर वी कैन सी the road traffic is just about to increase. Now it has increased. Then the other problem is the formation of rods and the sobbing, that is waves and deformations. Then the next issue is your fonts problem, shortage of fonts. And then once we come across with all these problems along with the fonts, then we'll think of how to prepare develop a method of rehabilitating the existing pavement and which should be sustainable. Okay, then coming to pavement rehabilitation, it can be discussed under the following heads. We have got structural overlay. Under structural overlay, we can have the asphalt concrete overlay or the bituminous overlay or flexible overlay. Then we have got PCC, plain cement concrete overlay, and that is called that is known as white topping. And another is recycling of the existing pavement or materials and relaying. And the final option is reconstruction, when we are not able to execute any other thing and the road has damaged considerably without any scope for rehabilitation or maintenance, then we go for reconstruction. Okay. Then coming to the problems again, here we have got the first picture. We have got the ruttings, that is, with the help of a straight edge, we measure the depth from the straight edge. That is which is placed horizontally, and from that to the pavement surface, that is called the rot depth. And that rotting is normally occurring along the wheel paths, because the loads or wheel load movements is concentrated along a particular width of the pavement. Thereby, there will be the deformation or stress will be more, and because of that, we have got the rotting. Similarly, we have got the second problem, that is raveling, which is normally the loss of aggregates from the pavement surface during its lifetime, and this is because of several reasons that we may be discussed later on. Then the third problem is your pothole. Today we have got a small hole on the pavement surface, and mostly these potholes, they appear in the rainy season, and they go on expanding as the vehicles move on the pavement, and the pavement is not attended to. So then the cracking. So here also in the first picture we see different cracks. Mostly these cracks, they are confined to the wheel track. Okay. Next, rotting of bituminous pavement is a common problem in hot climates like India, subjected to heavy traffic loads. So mostly in a climate in our country, we come across with the problem of rotting, and we want to overcome this problem. A PCC overlay is usually recommended for bituminous pavements where rotting is a recurring problem. Since we in our country we have got a recurring problem with rotting, we can overcome this by providing a PCC overlay. Concrete overlays offer the potential for extended service life, increased structural and functional capacity, reduced maintenance requirements, and lower life cycle costs when compared with bituminous overlay alternatives. Then coming to white topping is an engineered method of placement of concrete overlay on existing distressed bituminous pavement. So first picture, you can see how the blocks, as it looks like different small blocks, they placed over bituminous pavement. So we have got we have come across the word black topping, which is normally, since the top looks like black in color in bituminous pavement, we call it black top. And the reverse is case in case of cement concrete pavement, as it looks nearly white, and that is called white topping. The concrete layer is placed either with bonding. Also, when you place the concrete layer above the existing pavement, so it could be with the bond, with proper bond with the lower layer, or without bonding, and accordingly the design is made. So coming to types of white topping, we have got the depending upon the thickness of overlay, we can have conventional white topping, which is normally taken up when the overlay thickness is more than 200 millimeter. And here we refer IRC 58 2015, that is the code for design of rigid pavement, that is taken care of when the overlay thickness is more than 200 millimeter. And coming to thin white topping, when the thickness is overlay thickness is in the range of 100 to 200 millimeter. And another is ultra thin white topping, where the overlay thickness is within 100 millimeter. And coming to the bonding aspect with the existing bituminous pavement or hot mix asphalt pavement, it could be bonded, it could be unbonded, or it could be partially bonded. And accordingly, when we decide this bonding or unbonding or partial bonding, we have to choose the parameters for design. So coming to conventional white topping, similar to a new concrete pavement, and can be directly laid on the existing bituminous pavement without much surface preparation. So we don't need any rehabilitation or profile correction. Simply we can put the same pavement quality concrete to get the profile correction, as well as the layer thickness which we will be providing as, say, overlay. Designed and constructed without consideration of any bond between the concrete overlay and underlying bituminous layer, without assuming any composite action. So when you think of bonding, then we can go for composite action. If you do, there is no bond, so there will be no composite action or composite action. Coming to thin white topping and the conventional white topping, do not have a very rigid demarcation line, and the thickness between 150 mm to 250 mm is quite common. So this is how we go for the white topping. Coming to thin white topping, as we have discussed in the earlier slides, so thickness is between 100 to 200 millimeter, and milling desirable but thin bituminous overlay of 25 to 50 millimeter in lieu of milling can be used. So this is to provide on the existing pavement, we allow milling so that the overlay can have a proper bond with the existing one. And in the process also, if some undulations are there within the range of 25 to 50, that can also be taken care of. Bonding desirable, though not mandatory. So when you go for thin white topping, bonding, we can consider bonding or we can avoid that. But when it is ultra thin white topping, bonding is mandatory. So the bonding consideration may be ignored in the design. High strength concrete with fibers is recommended. So our IRC 40 SP 46 provides the either the use of fibers, or IRC SP 114 that provides for this thing, the use of silica fumes to get high strength concrete. So that can be taken up. So high strength concrete either could be using silica fumes or using these fibers. Then with shorter joint spacing, so joints which we are providing here, it is only in the range of 0.6 to 1.25 meter. On the contrary, in the normal conventional pavement, we provide say minimum of 2.5 to 2.75 to a maximum of 4.5 meter. So here we have reduced the joint spacing so that we have got some panels, small panels, used of low to moderate rate traffic road. So when the traffic is in the range of either low or moderate, we can go for thin white topping. Then ultra thin white topping, bonding is mandatory, as we have already, I have already told you. Milling the existing bituminous surface to an average depth of 25 millimeter is normally used. So the equipment or milling machine is available that can be run over the existing pavement. So where we can have this milling action, and the depth of milling is only to a depth of 25 millimeter. So that is adjusted in the machine itself, and that is. And the another limitation is that minimum thickness of the existing bituminous surface should be 75 millimeter. That means after milling, whatever thickness available in the bituminous, that should be minimum of 75 millimeter. Then only we can have this ultra thin white topping. High strength concrete with the fibers is normally provided with costly, with closely spaced joints, as we have discussed. The joints are in the range of 0.6 to 1.25 millimeter. Ultra thin white topping of 50 millimeter to 75 millimeter, that is less than 100 millimeter, is generally not recommended for Indian conditions. So even if this technique is there, ultra thin white topping, we do not normally recommend because of the experience or lack of experience or in this thin white topping. So the ultra thin white topping we don't recommend for Indian conditions. Cannot be used on a badly cracked bituminous surface which has been severely damaged. There we cannot put because the prerequisites are much more costlier before we put the ultra thin white topping. So ultra thin white topping cost efficient for intersections where we have got extra force because of the curvature and braking effect on these things. Then check posts and toll plazas, parking lots and roads with frequent routing problems. So there we can have the advantage of providing ultra thin white topping. The factors affecting the design of white topping, these factors are existing pavement, white topping thickness, PCC existing bituminous pavement, the bond between the existing PCC and the existing, say, existing bituminous and the overlay in the form of PCC. Then traffic condition, concrete materials, climatic considerations, and joints. So the existing pavement, key to the success of any concrete pavement, including ultra thin white topping or thin white topping overlay, is a uniform and stable support system. It is obvious when you have got a uniform support, then the overlying layer will not provide any depressions or undulations if you have got a uniform support. So a thicker concrete overlay should be considered if the support layers have exhibited poor structural support. So that means in terms of CVR or modulus of subgrade reaction K, if you have got lower values, then you can think of a thicker overlay. PCC HMA bond is necessary for ultra thin white topping and some thin white topping. So in case of thin white topping, we can ignore the bond or we can have the provision of bond. So accordingly, the parameters are to be considered in the design. Then existing pavement also in it includes pre-overlay repair. So this is a prerequisite before you lay the overlay. Conventional white topping overlays do not require extensive pre-overlay repairs, but the repair of certain types of distresses may be important to avoid localized failure. So the conventional white topping means it is just like the pavement which you are designing as per IRC 58. So there we don't go for profile correction, etc. The PQC which you are using only after repairing the severe damaged areas, we can put the overlay, where the PQC itself will make up for the depressions or undulations. For thin white topping, all distresses should be rectified before concrete overlay. That is mandatory here. Then we have got pavement evaluation, then surface preparation. So pre-overlay repair for conventional white topping. So we have got a table here, general pavement condition, where we have got a rotting depth less than 50 millimeter. So non or milling recommended repair. and rotting is greater than equal to 50 meter, milling or leveling, sobbing. So that sobbing is the depressions followed by bulging. So that just like waving surfaces because parallel to the pavement, in the direction of vehicular movement. So in that case also we recommend milling so that we can have a level platform so that above which we can provide the overlay. Then potholes, the potholes are to be repaired or filled with crossed stone cold mixture or hot mixture. Then we have got subgrade failure, remove and replace or repair if it is subgrade, because the problem is with the subgrade, that is the foundation of the pavement. So it has to be repaired or it has to be removed, so that then only we can put the new one. Otherwise, if the problem is there, whatever may be the action which you are taking in the uppermost layer, that will not, the problem will be still there because the foundation is not providing the adequate support. Then cracking, so recommendation or nothing is to be carried out, only because when you put the overlay, automatically the cracks will be filled up with the slurry in the concrete. Then bleeding, raveling, there is no need, because that will be taken care of by the overlay which will be putting. There will be no problem absolutely. Then pavement evaluation. Evaluation of the existing pavement is an essential part of any overlay design, including conventional white topping. Field evaluation typically consists of a visual distress survey, that is pavement condition, which we normally through a survey we assess the condition of the pavement in terms of patching, cracking, etc. Distress survey, then deflection testing using Benkelman beam or falling well deflectometer and coring. So this Benkelman beam deflection, that is IRC 81, the provision is there how to find out the characteristic deflection and how to design for the overlay. Similarly, we have got a falling weight deflectometer, that is IRC 115, special by IRC 115. So that is the guideline for falling weight deflectometer, finding the deflection, etc. Where the deflection by bowl, the shape of the deflection bowl is taken into consideration, unlike the Benkelman beam where we do not have that provision. Foundation support value K is key information for thickness D. Definitely when you go for designing the pavement, particularly the overlay in the form of PCC, so the modulus of subgrade reaction K is very much important, because this provides the input and this decides what should be the thickness of the pavement. So that is the modulus of subgrade reaction K. Then pavement evaluation, type and thickness of the existing layers. So it has to be assessed what is the existing pavement, what are the different layers existing, and what is the thickness of each layer in good condition. Then type and extent of distress, what is the extent to which you have got the defects in the pavement, and those distresses have to be evaluated and action taken care of accordingly. Restriction on finished road top level, when the road, there is no provision for, or the road for finished top level cannot have, we cannot have any bridging of the road top level, then we have to decide what is to be taken care of, so that the final top level, even after putting the overlay, we don't go beyond the road top level, which is restricted. Width of existing pavement and proposed concrete overlay, presence of treacherous soil like black cotton soil, special precautionary measures have to be taken in case of BC soil. The drainage condition, drainage requirements, and subsurface drainage. So all these things are to be assessed. Then we have got surface preparation. For conventional white topping, no special efforts are made to encourage bonding between the overlay and the underlying bituminous surface. So conventional white topping, as I have already told you, it is just as good as your IRC 58. So there is whatever may be the condition of the existing pavement, we don't go for assuming any bond between the existing pavement and the overlay. However, some steps for surface preparations may be required to address distress in the existing surface. So, when there are some local defects or local depressions are there, those can be filled up and we can put the overlay to just reduce the cost of PQC. Three methods of surface preparation and overlaying are normally used for white topping. First is direct placement, that means without making any treatment to the existing pavement. Then milling, that is to make the level platform or to have a profile correction in the form of not putting extra layer, but by just milling, we can have a rough surface on the top of which we can have the overlay. Then placement of leveling course. So this leveling course normally is the profile correction which you provide on the top of the pavement to have the top of the or the bottom of the existing pavement to proper profile both transversely and longitudinally, so that we can with necessary camber and longitudinal gradient, so that we can put the overlay on it without going for any precautionary measure as regards to the gradients both longitudinally and transversely. Then coming to surface preparation, that is direct placement, the concrete overlay is placed directly on the existing hot mix asphalt after correcting the profile with concrete. So the concrete which is used for PQC, that concrete can be used. Otherwise, you can have use the DLC, which is a low grade concrete, to make the profile correct. Depressions on the top of the existing pavement. Above that, you can put the PQC in the form of overlay. Milling the existing bituminous surface is milled to obtain a uniform surface, that is a surface which has got proper to proper profile both longitudinally and transversely. The removal of thickness should be between 25 to 50 millimeters. So the milling thickness or depth should be in the range of 25 to 50. Minimum should be 25 and maximum 50. Placement of leveling course. Sometimes a leveling course of bituminous macadam 50 mm or DLC 75 is provided for profile correction. So alternately, for profile correction, you can have the bituminous macadam, which is normally cheap, a minimum thickness of 50 mm, or otherwise you can have DLC, which is also less costly in comparison to PQC, which can be provided for profile correction. Then coming to traffic characterization, we normally don't have the traffic in terms of volume when we go for designing the structural portion. It is in the form of axle load survey. So the axle load spectra for the road present day, and it has to be projected for the future years, and then that is the design period, and we will have the information on the axle load plying on the road. Then seasonal distribution of traffic, normally it is there. We have got peak season and lean season, and maybe even in the hours of the day or days of the week, we can have the traffic variation. So that variation is to be considered also. And the growth factor normally, which is there, minimum of 6% as per our IRC codes, minimum of 6% is to be considered when we don't have any data on the growth factors. The design of conventional white topping. So design, as I have already told you, design principle adopted for conventional white topping is similar to those of normal concrete pavements as provided in IRC 58/2015. So when the thickness is coming more than 200 millimeter, we normally go for this. Then two methods to determine the modified value of a K are suggested in this guideline. So when you go for designing the thickness, we need the modulus of subgrade reaction. Since we are putting the conventional white topping on the top of the existing pavement, we need to know the K value of the bituminous layer. And that can be assessed by two methods, and which will be suggested in the next slide. The modified K value for the bituminous top can be found out from the nomographs, depending upon whether asphalt surface is on the granular base or on the symmetric. So depending upon the base course, whether it is cement-treated base or asphalt base, and we can have two separate charts to find out the K value on the top of the existing bituminous layer. Alternately, from deflection survey, the K value, deflection survey, particularly the Beckelmann deflection, characteristic deflection, we can have a correlation between the characteristic deflection obtained from Beckelmann beams method with the, say, K value. So the K value of the existing pavement can be determined. Then here we have got the picture where we have got on the left side, that is KS, or the box you can see, KS is the subgrade, then the next layer is H2, that is granular base, and H1 is asphalt surface. And on the top of this asphalt surface, we are interested to find out the K modulus of subgrade reaction. So what do we do? We first go to the left side where we have got the modulus of subgrade reaction of the subgrade. So that is 0 to 90. So we first assess the K value of the subgrade. Then we go to the y-axis and suppose it is say within 10 to 20, that point is marked there, then we go to the respective base coarse thickness. If it is granular, so any curve that is say 150 mm curve, it is intersecting, suppose 150 millimeter is the thickness of the granular base, which could be in the form of GSP or WBM or WMM, whatever may be the granular base layer. So that curve, if its thickness is 150 millimeter, then it intersects the subgrade of KS line, intersects the curve that is 150 mm thickness of GSP granular base, then that is again projected upwards to meet the thickness curve of the asphalt layer. So that thickness is normally, we after that removing that say milling, that means whatever, if at all we are going for milling, that is 25 to 50, you remove that, so that thickness should be taken into consideration. Suppose it is again 150 millimeter of bituminous layer, then we arrive at a K value of around say 45 or 44 like that on the right side. So where we can have, this is the modulus of subgrade reaction on the top of the existing asphalt layer, which will be used in the design. Similarly, in the other graph where only the difference is here, instead of granular base, we have got the cemented base. Same procedure, we go to the left side, that is y-axis, we have the modulus of subgrade reaction, then it intersects the curve which has got a particular thickness of cemented base. From there, we go to the curve where it intersects the thickness of the existing asphalt pavement, and again we go to the right side where we get the modulus of subgrade reaction on the top of the asphalt pavement. So this is how we get the modified K value because of the existing layers which are in good condition, and that K value is to be used in the design purpose. Then another graph, this is the correlation between the characteristic deflection obtained in the Benkelman deflection studies, and that is correlated to the K value on the top of the asphalt pavement. So this is how we get the K value on the top of the existing pavement over which we are laying the overlay. So then design of thin white tapping. So once that conventional time, once we know the K value and the other parameters, strictly we go to IRC 58 where we design the pavement as per the guidelines in IRC 58. Then coming to the next one, design of thin white tapping. Structural behavior of thin white tapping is quite complex because here you can have the option, you can have the bond or you may not have the bond. Design is based on composite action of the bituminous layer and PCC overlay. So if you are considering the bond, definitely the composite action will be coming into picture. So that has to be considered. Otherwise, you can have the separate layers when there is no bond. Pavement should therefore be analyzed as a composite system in which the concrete and bituminous layers are characterized by the thickness, elastic properties, all on top of a K value for the subgrade. So when you go for the designing the thickness of the thin white tapping, then the properties of the white tapping, that is the elastic properties, maybe modulus of elasticity, then the Poisson's ratio, etc. Then the similarly the bottom layer, that bituminous layer, its elastic properties, and each layer thickness have to be considered. And once we know the K value of the subgrade, then we go for the design. The degree of composite action assumed in the analysis has significant influence on the stress developed. So this what is the degree of bonding, what should be accordingly, you have to get the result for the composite behavior of the pavement. Here we have got the picture for bonding of PCC with the bituminous hot mix asphalt or there is no bond. So first one, you see the neutral axis is in the, that is when there is unbonded, so the neutral axis is in the top layer, that is a conventional bond, bituminous pavement, or sorry, conventional white topping when we don't have any bond with the bottom bituminous layer. So in that case, we have got the compression, because of the loading, compression will be at the top layer, then the bottom layer of the PCC will have tension, and again on the top of the bituminous layer will have compression, and the bottom of the bituminous layer will have tension. Similarly, here, if it is, we consider the composite axon which is bonded, the neutral axis shifts downward. That means at the interface between the bituminous pavement and the PCC pavement overlay, the stress is reduced to great extent, and that is, so the neutral axis shifts towards the bottom, towards the interface between the bituminous pavement and the PCC overlay. So this is how the loading is, compression is on the top because that is in the overlay, PCC overlay, and stress is reduced to great extent at the interface. And when we go to the again bottommost layer, we will have the tension. The design of thin white roping. The results of mechanistic analysis suggest that load stresses depend upon the slab size, that is joint proximity, obvious joint spacing, and bonding of PCC layer with asphalt. So these are the two parameters. One is joint spacing, and that decides the length and width of the panel, and the bonding of PCC layer with asphalt pavement. There is a substantial reduction in load stress as the slab size decreases. It is obvious when the we have got the more length of the slab or width of the slab, that definitely the stresses will be more. When you have short panels, the stress will be decreased. This is also true for curling and warping. So curling is a phenomenon because of the temperature gradient, and as well as when you have got warping, that is because of the moisture gradient in the pavement. So that is also reduced because when you have got a short panels, where we have don't have any constraint, or we have got less constraint in comparison to when we have large panel sizes. Design is based on stress due to load and temperature. So the design is based on loading and the temperature variation, then the stress ratio, which is normally the fraction of, on the numerator we have got the flexural stress imposed, and the on the denominator you have got the flexural strength of the material, that is concrete. So that is your stress ratio. As we know in the IRC 58, when we have got a stress ratio of less than equal to 0.45, the pavement can material can take infinite repetitions irrespective of the magnitude of the load. So that is how we are interested to have a stress ratio more or less nearly equal to 0.45. may not be practically possible, but we should try so that our stress ratio is as low as possible. And then fatigue characteristics, we have got the cracking because of the repeated load of applications. We have got top down cracking and bottom up cracking, and those phenomena have been clearly described in IRC 58. Once top down cracking is during night time and the bottom up cracking during daytime. So because of the temperature difference between the top and bottom layer of the PCC slab or the overlay thickness. So that is the fatigue characteristics. Then we have got load carrying mechanism of short panels. What is the advantage? So the load can be resisted either by bending or by deflection. But in the first case, you see, just short joint spacings are used so that the energy is absorbed by deflection rather than bending. So in the second case, we see that the load is resisted because of the deflection. Because since we have got panels of a small size, so before it bends, it will try to tend to deflect. But in the first case, since there is no scope for deflection as compared to the second one, here the stress is distributed and we have got the axon loading, external loading rather, is resisted by the bending action of the slab. Then concrete materials, conventional cement, concrete or fast track concrete materials, then fiber reinforced concrete using fibers, maybe polypropylene, polyethylene, nylon, polyester, steel, as per IRC SP 46. So that is the use of fibers in cement concrete to get high strength. Now high performance concrete using mineral admixtures, maybe silica fume up to 3 to 10%. We have got a separate IRC code, that is IRC 114, which say how to design the cement concrete mix using silica fumes. By weight of cementation material, with and without using fly ash up to 20% or slag up to 70% by weight of cement. Then the slag replacement or the cement replacement by slag or cement replacement by say fly ash as per IRC SP 72. Most more or less when we are going for this slag or cement fly ash replacement, definitely it should be the cement should be OPC. Then concrete materials, grade of concrete should be AM40 because as per IRC 40 IRC 58, the minimum flexural strength should be 4.5 MPa. So that is obtained if you know the cube strength, that is 0.7 root over FCK, that will be giving you the tentative bending strength, flexural strength of concrete. Without going for a beam test, you can have this correlation between the compressive strength and the flexural strength. So grade of concrete minimum M40 or more. High performance concrete M50 is normally preferred for this thin white tower topping. High strength, high performance concrete is essential for fast track construction, since we have to construct the track at a very fast speed, and by using mechanized method of construction, definitely we need our concrete to get strength as early as possible. Minimum flexural strength or modulus of rupture, 3-point loading of the concrete shall be 4.5 MPa. So either we can go for this beam test or 3-point loading to get the 4 or an indirect measure can be by using the that correlation 0.7 FCK is equal to your flexural strength. However, it is preferred to have a flexural strength of 5 to 6 MPa. Then climatic considerations. One of the key factors contributing to premature failure of thin white trapping or ultra thin is high pouring temperature. So the temperature at which you are laying the slab. So that is the air temperature at which we are placing the concrete in place. So sections poured at temperature below 30 degrees centigrade with 100 mm of underlying asphalt performs well. And these two criteria are recommended for thin white trapping and ultra thin white trapping applications. So the temperature should be 30 degrees centigrade or below 30 degrees centigrade, and the underlying layer should have minimum thickness of 100 mm. So these are the two criteria considered while placing the overlay. Then coming to joints, in case of thin white tapping, when thickness is less than 150 mm, provision of the use of dial bars may be omitted. So in conventional white tapping, where IRC 58 says the dowel bars are necessary for a pavement thickness of 200 mm or more. Now here, that means below 200 mm, we need not go for placing dowel bars. That aggregate interlock developed at the joints would automatically take care of the action which will be subsequently given by dowel bars. So there is no need of dowel bars in case of pavement of thickness greater than or equal to 200 millimeter. Here also in thin water topping, similar action is, there is no need for this thing, dowel bars, provision of dowel bars when we have a thickness less than 150 mm, because the we make a cut up to 1/3 depth of the slab, and from there towards the bottom we develop because of the loading or the development of automatic crack, and that to crack interlock the two portions of the slab, and that aggregate interlock will take care of the load transfer. So joint spacing for thin white tapping and ultra thin white tapping overlays are very short in order to reduce the magnitude of curling and bending stresses. So the joint spacing which we have short, particularly 0.6 to 1.25 to reduce the effect of curling and bending stresses, we need that the panel should be as short as possible. Load transfer is provided by aggregate interlock. This I have already told you. That means a crack develops just below the joint depth. If you have, particularly the joints are up to a depth of 1/3 of the thickness of the overlay, and from that level to the bottom of the slab, a crack hair crack line develops, and the crack is not absolutely straight, it is zigzag. Now that means in the form of interlock, it will be there. So that it is called aggregate interlock, which is further enhanced by short joint spacing and by the support of underlying pavement. Compared to conventional pavements, load transfer is not as critical for concrete overlays because the underlying pavement provides considerable support to the joints. So definitely, because prior to going for laying the overlay, we know that our existing pavement has got sufficient strength because it is not the subgrade, it is the bituminous layer, and which is in good condition of adequate thickness, so that the support to be provided to the panels coming over it is better rather than the normal concrete pavement, where we have to place the white topping on the top of the subgrade or subbase. Contraction joints are provided by cutting groups for a depth of 1/3, I have already told you, of the depth of white topping at a spacing of 12 to 18 times, that which we have called 0.6 to say 1.25 meter, that is the spacing. So that is in the normal, in the range of that spacing is 12 to 18 times the thickness of overlay in longitudinal azimuthal transfer direction, so that we can have the panels only. Ratio of length to width of any given panel is recommended to be no more than 1.5, although some recommend, some researchers, they recommend the use of up to a maximum length to breadth ratio of 1.25. Then the next step is, after design, we have got the construction of white topping. So this is first step is surface preparation, under this we cover the cleaning of the existing surface and milling of the existing surface to a depth of 25 to 50 millimeter by mechanized mode, that is through a machine we execute this. Then placing of overlay, use of a slip form or fixed form pavers. Normally this is mechanized mode of execution, so either the slip form which you will be placing on the sides, either it should be slip form or fixed form, and each form has got its own advantage and disadvantages. So then using vibrated screed, so definitely screed vibrators are used because the thickness is more small, and screed vibrators or plate vibers are normally used, so that shaking action is, vibrating action is there, so that the compaction is taken care of them by this equipment. Then we have got finishing and texturing. Normally carpet drag or brooming is if it is volume of work, it is very very small, we can go for small brooming, but otherwise it is always mechanical brooming or the carpet dragging, dragging a carpet on the top of the, so that it will have a rough surface. Then curing, normally spraying liquid or ponding water, but since it is a mechanized mode of work to having a construction of track very fast, we always go for membrane curing, where a liquid or membrane layer is put on the top of the concrete, so that the heat of hydration which is evaporated or liberated and dissipated, that is executed in a controlled manner. Then joint sawing and sealing. So the cutting of the joints, that is whether it is at 0.6 or to 1.25 millimeter or something like that. So we have a thickness of 3 to say 5 millimeter width joint cut from the top to 1/3 of the depth of the or thickness of the overlay. And this is done by scratch test. That means scratch, when we put a scratch, we see that only just that mark is there, but it is not piercing into the concrete. At that stage, we start cutting of the, sawing of the joint. And normally it takes, it starts from the time range of 6 hours to 18 hours. Depending upon the type or grade of concrete or the admixtures used, we can have this variation. 6 hours to 18 hours, we have to cut it to a depth of 1/3. Of the thickness of overlay and to a thickness of 3 to 5 millimeter. A latter, we can widen it when we put before sealing the top of the joint with sealant. Then coming to construction again, production of concrete should be done normally in a ready mix plant or in a dedicated batching plant. Either fixed form or slip form mechanical paver is used. Strict quality control at site, including testing of fresh, hardened and extracted specimens of concrete and test on pavement quality. So this is to know the strength of concrete which you are using in the field. Traffic can be opened when the concrete attains the desired strength depending on the traffic loading condition. Usually after 28 days of casting, paving quality concrete PQC or PC slabs, or at the age at which minimum compressive strength of 28 MPa is achieved. Normally this 25 minimum strength, at what stage or what number of days after the casting it has been achieved, can be done by core cutting, by removing the core and testing in the laboratory and getting a value of minimum 28 MPa, then we allow the traffic to move. Then distresses which are likely to occur in this type of pavement. Corner cracking appears to be the primary failure mode, and fatigue cracking is believed to be the primary failure mechanism in thin white topping and ultra thin white topping. So this has been shown in the right side, the first picture. And second picture, when the sawing is at a later stage, late joint sawing, misalignment of the dowel bars at construction joints leads to transverse cracking. So this is parallel to or along the alignment. So this is the we call across the panels. Then benefits of white topping: long life, low maintenance, low life cycle cost when you consider over the design period, improved safety and environmental benefits. Environmental benefits, particularly when you use this thing, all the as in the first lecture in the morning you are listening to, each whether it is flexible format or rigid format, each format has it got its own advantages and disadvantages in terms of ease of construction, in terms of cost of construction, and in terms of the speed of construction, all these things. So the availability of funds also. So that those things they are decided prior to the execution of the work. Bituminous overlays exhibit a more rapid loss of serviceability as compared to concrete white topping at some critical locations. Deformation like rotting and cracking predominant in case of bituminous pavement is normally absent with concrete surfaces of white topping. This is particularly true in a hot climate like India. That is why we recommend to practice this technique of white topping more and more in India and get the feedback through performance studies so that we can make proper steps to overcome the problems which will be coming up after providing this white topping. Then conventional white topping improves structural capacity of existing bituminous pavement, definitely, because we are putting an overlay. If built on a strong base course and it impedes structural resistance, definitely when we are having good bituminous layer and above that we are providing the overlays, definitely the structural strength of that existing pavement is definitely much better in comparison to the subgrade which over which we are providing the conventional rigid pavement. White topping is quite cost effective to tackle annual budget constraints and high traffic levels. So it is therefore quite relevant to Indian conditions. Concrete is relatively light in color and hence concrete surface is more reflective to light, absorb less heat and reduce the urban heat island effect. So that urban heat island effect in urban areas, if you have got the BT road, in the morning session you have Dr. Sau has talked a lot on reflective surface, how to get less energy radiation and more through reflection. So here I suggest that when we have got the city center or urban area covered entirely through say bituminous pavement, which is a black body, and it absorbs more heat or energy, and later on it when it radiates, the the urban center will be just like a heat island. And that effect can be reduced to great extent if you go for this white topping over the existing bituminous surface, so to reduce that heat island effect in the urban area or city center. Improved reflection of lights from vehicles enhances safety, lowers energy requirement of external lighting, lower contribution to heat in the environment. Fuel consumption on concrete roads has been found to be less than bituminous road, definitely, because the friction is comparatively less and the fuel consumption and the riding quality is better. So definitely the vehicle operation cost will be less. So the life cycle cost analysis, and this has been carried out by Central Road Research Institute of New Delhi, and they have found, say, they have got in the y-axis they have got a scale, say 0 to 14, and the conventional white topping, then ultra thin white topping, then the rigid pavement, then flexible pavement. So the lower one is the gray color construction cost, then the maintenance cost. So this gives a comparative study of the life cycle cost, that is the cost during the project period or the design period of each type of pavement. Coming to summary, the conclusions. Interface bonding is the most important factor that affects the longevity of thin white topping. So whether we go for bonding or without bonding, so that decides. So that interface bonding, that is the bonding between the bottom of the overlay and the top of the existing pavement, so that decides the life of the overlay. Interface bonding has a more dominant effect in case of ultra thin white topping in comparison to conventional white topping and thin bonding. So that is why in this guidelines, then normally for conventional white topping or thin white topping, that bonding is not considered. But in ultra thin white topping, where the thickness is less than 100 millimeter, the bonding is mandatory and that has to be considered. Otherwise, the composite action may not be there and the top layer overlay may fail. The top layer, bottom layer will be as it is, but the top layer will fail. It will be just waste. The minimum required overlay thickness should be based on traffic data, existing asphalt layer thickness, and mode of failure. Corner cracking is the most common type of distress found in ultra-thin white topping projects. If the stiffness ratio of the PCC and the hot mix layers falls below 1, then there is an increase in the potential of existing crack in the hot mix well to propagate upwards into the white. That means the stiffness of the upper layer, in terms of its modulus of elasticity, should be much more than that of the asphalt layer over which it is put. Otherwise, the cracks which are developing or which have developed and not attended to on the top of the existing pavement, when that is vitreous layer, will propagate to the overlay. So ultimately, that will lead to the failure of the overlay. So that is why this stiffness ratio should be more than 1. So that to how to have our overlay in good condition. Incorporation of fibers and supplementary cementitious materials in concrete reduces the cost of project as well as giving other benefits. So that is why we go for high strength concrete by using silica fumes or the fibers. Future research needs. So this is not the end of this codal provision. So what more is needed so that we can come across the problems and finally think of the solutions for the problems which we will be facing. Behavior of white topping is dependent on several field related issues. So more field studies need to be conducted to observe the actual behavior of overlay. So in India, just in most of cases, we just construct and forget about the after studies. So after study only for pilot projects we carry out, but it has to be whenever we are going for a new technology or being adopted or being put in use, after studies is mandatory so that we can get the feedback, get the problems, and then we think of the solutions. Studies on combined effect of loading, temperature, environmental conditions, joint spalling. So in the what is generally happens in the case of rigid pavements, the edges of the pavements are not in the same level, same profile is not there at the joint maintained at the joints. So that is called joint spalling, and supporting base condition of overlay should be done. More application of white topping technology should be implemented in India to gain experience. So once we adopt this technology, then only we come across the problems, and once we have got the problem, then we can think of the solutions. If you don't adopt it, we don't use it, then there is no experience, there is no problem, there will be no solution. So any new technology which will be coming up, it has to be implemented and it has to be studied, and the problems are to be assessed, and next the solution is to be thought of. So thank you, dear participants. And so we have come to the conclusion. Now, Professor Sujit Pradhan, any question from the participants?
Yes, 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 sir. Thank you, sir. And we have some questions.
I am in time.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir, for your punctual. You are always punctual. Okay. So thank you, sir. Sir, some questions I'm taking out, Charlie.
Okay, just
okay, sir. Sir, in case of thin white topping,
yes.
You have some in some slides, there is corner cracking as there. So yes. How to overcome that one, actually? Because it is, corner cracking is more probable, actually, when traffic will come.
Rigid pavement, which is having more thickness more than 200 mm, we have that problem of corner cracking, and that is because of at the corners we have got free expansion and contraction, and because of the free expansion and contraction at the corners, so the slab will tend to curl upwards or downwards. So when it curls, it will lose contact with the supporting layer, And if at all at that point of time we put a load on the corner, so what happens that the stress will be more because the contact area is less, because we know the stress is the load divided by the area perpendicular to the direction of force which is acting. And since the area, that is the denominator, the area decreases, so that load is there. Even if with the same load, we get the less area, and that is why the corner cracking will be there. And that corner cracking phenomenon can be reduced by taking suitable measures of slightly anchoring down at the corners, providing some measures so that, because if you have got good friction between the, say, bottom layer over which it is put and the top bottom of the overlay, so that means that to then may not allow the concrete layer to lose contact with the bottom layer. So if you can develop some mechanism where we can have good amount of friction existing at the corners between the top and the bottom layer, and because of the self weight of the pavement, it sticks to its original position even because of the temperature variations, so there will be less chance of the corner cracks.
Okay, sir. In case of thin white topping,
yes.
can we provide reinforcement?
Reinforcement actually, because the thickness is very small. Normally, when you go for rigid pavement design, or IRC 58 says, whenever we go for providing reinforcement, it is not for taking any supporting the bending action. It is only to prevent cracking if at all it occurs. That is why the reinforcement is put at the top of the slab, so that if a crack develops at the top, that crack will not be allowed to propagate towards the bottom, and to counter that we provide reinforcement at the top of the slab. Okay, so reinforcement has got no issue or solution only at the corners or the junctions where extra stresses are induced. There we can provide mild dose of reinforcement. Otherwise, reinforcement has got no supporting role in case of this rigid pavement. And only if you have high strength concrete where we provide the fibers, fibers could be of any material. In that case, these fibers, when the pavement is subject to tension at the top, these fibers, they take care of this way, or they prevent rather the cracking action which will be normally occurring at the top. So instead of this reinforcement, we can have this high strength concrete using the fibers, maybe any type of fibers which I have discussed, or maybe in case of small steel fibers, different types of fibers are used. And for that, we have got this IRC 46, SP 46 is there, where we can use the different types of fiber to get advantage of the concrete material. Okay.
Okay, okay. Sir, another problem.
Yes.
This white topping is placed upon the existing flexible pavement.
Yes.
Clear, sir?
Yes.
So extra milling of existing pavement is necessary?
Milling is necessary because in the first case, when we have the conventional pavement of thickness more than 200 millimeter, we don't need this milling. But the undulations, they are filled up with a DLC, and above for profile correction, then we can have directly lay the PQC, because the cost of PQC is much more than DLC. But when it is thickness is less than 200 millimeter and in the range of 100 to 200 millimeter, even if we in the design we consider the absolute there is no bond, but we go for milling so that we have some amount of bond with the existing pavement. At the same time, through this milling, the small undulations, small variations along and across the pavement, that can be taken care of if we go for milling to up to a particular depth. So that the top of the layer, which will be bituminous layer, which will be receiving the overlay, it will be the profile will be absolutely right, both longitudinally and transversely. So milling is mandatory. But milling in the third case, when we go for ultra thin white topping, which normally do not recommend in India, there it is mandatory. But here, to just have some extra safety or measures or care, we go for milling. And that milling is not to be with manual measures, with mechanized mode. Okay.
Okay, can it use in expressway, because where there is a heavy traffic or traffic is more. So as the thin white topping, the thickness is less. So it can it sustain.
No, ultra thin white topping will not be there, but thin white topping, the thickness is 100 to 200, so that will be there. So the very purpose is when we are putting, because the expressway, when you are putting, normally when it is, when we call it as expressway or national highway, it has got certain standards or labels in comparison to other roads, where we have not that much of problem. And when we see, because in every 5 years you have to put the renewal code. So any type of road, whether it is expressway, normal national highway, in addition to the normal maintenance in the form of patch repair, crack repair, etc., etc., inflexible pavement. In every 5 years, even if the surface condition is good, we go for a renewal coat to protect our structural layer below it. So, in that case, if you provide thin white, suppose it is after 5 years, we see that our pavement condition is good, that does not require any resurfacing. But the codal provision says every 5 years we have to put a resurfacing layer. So instead of that, if we can go for this thin white topping in the form of 100 to 200 mm, so the life period, even if 2 to 3 span, that means 2 to 3 maintenance period, maybe 15 years or 10 to 15 years, after that we may need for the resurfacing. That is not necessary. So mainly because the rotting problem, which is because of the heavy traffic load in Indian conditions, as well as the temperature variation, which is there in most of the flexible pavement, we don't have any failure because of cracking. It is mostly because of rotting. And once rotting is there, and in the wheel path we get the cracks developed, so definitely to counteract the effect of rotting, we can, even if we, whether it is in national highway or expressway, if you go for thin white topping in the range of 100 to 200 millimeter, again it has to be designed by, say, that finite element analysis method. We're taking small panels, then the bond between existing pavement, the materials used, the elastic properties of the existing pavement, as well as the elastic properties of the materials which will be put on the overlay. So many parameters, then we will arrive at the thickness of the overlay. And there we can also put, there is no harm.
Sir, what about its impact? I mean, can you use it in an airport pavement?
Impact? Airport pavement, because mostly in the airport we use that rigid pavement. Mostly the runways or the taxis where the aircraft's movements are concentrated, there mostly we use rigid pavement. We don't go for flexible pavement. Flexible pavement is only for the areas where the frequent movement of aircraft is not there. So in these areas we can use no problem, because otherwise, because we have got two methods. One is say equivalent single wheel load, and the another is load repetitions. More load repetitions are there in our higher traffic, but that load repetitions is much less in say airport, where we prefer rigid pavement. And mostly the area where frequent movement of aircraft is there, where we use rigid pavement, not the flexible pavement. Only other areas where for the service vehicles which we use to take the passengers to the aircraft or get down the passengers from the aircraft to the airport, in those areas we have got the BT pavement. They are also in that BT pavement area where we can put the thin white topping, no problem.
Okay, sir. Sir, in plant areas, basically in plant area.
Yes.
Where heavy machines are operating, so there will be vibrational effect on the thin white topping roads.
To energy
vibration,
because the thickness, when it is a composite action, that will be transmitted to the lower layer. But when it is only thin and put on the top, it may not work. But in that case, in plant areas where we use the vehicles, heavy vehicles rather. There we have got another alternate solution where we can go for this block pavements, because block pavements in container yards and where the traffic is very heavy and the speed is low, there we can go for the block pavement, that is IRC SP63 is there, where you can have the concrete blocks, small blocks ranging from the thickness of 60 to 120. Normally 100 to 120 they are used in the plant areas where we can use. and that block payment, advantage of block payment can be taken care of can be achieved through plant areas where heavy vehicles are moving and where also speed is low.
Okay, sir, nowadays recycling of materials is a cost effective way. So can we use recycled concrete aggregate for the design of five topping thin or ultra thin?
No problem, because the same thing when you are recycling asphalt pavement, you are using, you are just simply, you are just reusing the materials. Same thing when we have got the aggregates which we are using, whether it is from bituminous pavement or concrete pavement, because we are processing it and then we are using. And same concrete or dismantled concrete pavement or debris from where we are getting the concrete, and we are then through a crusher we can get the required sizes of aggregates, required grading. And once the design criteria is satisfied, that is when you go for mixed design, we know that yes, this should be this MPA, at this day this should be the MPA. And that is also possible, because that aggregate replacement is not 100%. We are virgin aggregates, we are putting some percentage, and these recycled aggregates, we are putting some percentage. So we are not using 100% these non-virgin aggregates. So in that case, the design, mixed design will be definitely meet the characteristics of the particular mix, whether it is M40 or M50. And once that is there, there is no harm. There is no need of thinking it, because that is the very purpose, is to get the target strength. By using the aggregates, if you are getting the target strength, then there is no harm. Okay. So that is the basis of design. So whether it is aggregate obtained from asphalt pavement or it is between concrete pavement, there is no bar there.
No. Okay. So it's okay. Thank you, sir, for joining us and accepting me our invitation to deliver a talk in RPC.
Thank you, Karthik. Thank you, Sujit, and thank you, Karthik, for organizing such a sir, program in this COVID era.
Sir, they are asking one question. Just one.
Okay, I'm there. Okay.
Actually, sir, Kundan sir asking, whenever we are designing, every vehicle is considered, or only you have to consider 3 tons vehicle?
When it is structural design, it is only the commercial vehicle, the definition of which the laden weight, that is gross laden weight of a vehicle, is more than 3 ton. Those vehicles which we are only considering, not any vehicle, because the other vehicles having less than 3 ton, they are only for traffic volume purpose, not for structural design. Structural design only for vehicles having gross laden weight more than 3 ton. Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you. And thank you, dear participants, for attending the program. Okay, sir.